One, two. This is a test. How are you doing? Can you hear me okay? Ladies and gentlemen, if you could begin to take your seats, we will begin in just a moment. Thank you.
You can bring it up.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to today's program. The format today consists of a presentation by President Frederick, followed by Q&A from the studio audience and previously submitted questions. As a courtesy, please silence your cell phones. Also, when we transition to Q&A, there are two mics positioned in the aisle. Please keep on your mask, state your name and affiliation. Also, please only two people in each queue at any given time. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the 17th president of Howard University, Dr. Wayne A.I. Frederick. Great.
So thank you. I'm going to jump right in to make sure that we leave as much time for questions as possible. In this presentation, we're going to cover quite a few topics, and as usual, we'll make this available as we post these afterwards so that people can certainly review these, and if they have any further questions, they can certainly contact us as well. And you see a list of topics here that I'll be reviewing. So first, let me start with campus safety and wellness. As I think of the threats to our community, this is probably the number one threat today. As we sit here, obviously, over the course of this semester, we've had issues around bomb threats, as well as we have current issues today with respect to the pandemic and rising infection rate on campus, which is why we have significant social distancing in the room today. And we're one of the few universities in the DMV area who never took down the mask mandate, and even with that, we've had a significant rise in the number of infections. So something for us to talk about today. So one of the things is, obviously, if you look across the country, in urban cities like ours, crime rate is up, and that's obviously of significant concern. However, crime on campus, as reported, has been down over the past academic year. Despite this, some of the incidents that are occurring are significant. We had a student in LaDroit Park just last week. I have a gunshot wound to his hand, which required surgery. And again, all of these are things that our Department of Public Safety works with the local Metropolitan Police to work out in terms of what the cause is, and obviously to try to put things in place to prevent this happening. The bomb threats have been a significant issue as well. We received four or five bomb threats over the course of about 6 weeks. These were particularly disruptive. Most of them occurred pretty early in the morning, and so we were able to sweep the campus and clear the campus prior to school starting, our business activities starting up. But the reality is that this is pretty disruptive and very costly, as you can imagine as well, when we have to interrupt this usual activity. And then it's very inconvenient to take students out to residence halls at 6 a.m. in the morning and have them out in the street, et cetera. The problem with some of these as well is that they did not specify exactly where on campus. So again, our obligation is safety first, so we've had to take extreme measures in order to manage these. And several HBCUs have been threatened, about 40. We've been engaging with the FBI around this issue, and we'll continue to do so as well. So we do want to remind folks about using Bison Safe. We think it's extremely important, and DPS has been putting on quite a few trainings. The attendance has been poor, but I do want to encourage folks that when DPS does advertise these activities, especially the trainings, that you would participate. I think there's a lot for all of us to learn, and unfortunately, that's the environment that we're living in. I've been in New York City earlier this week at the time of the unfortunate shooting in the subway in Brooklyn, and so this is something that obviously is plaguing our country and something that we have to all, unfortunately, be aware of in some way, shape, or form. One of the things with the emergency response is this is coordinated with several agencies, and so a lot of times when we send out messages about what measures we're taking, it's not just dependent on us making an internal decision, but a lot of times it's also dependent on advice and direction we're getting from elsewhere as well. So just to keep that in mind. I think the other thing with DPS and the safety committee is just making sure as well that we're getting feedback from students and faculty and staff about things that you may be seeing that may represent risk, because we certainly, as we try to improve, we want to get that feedback. And we're trying to incorporate modern tools. Obviously, we're using Bison Safe, and we're using other systems that would allow us to sound alarms and alerts to get, you know, more safety. In terms of Bison Safe, I want to definitely commend the entire community for really taking the Bison Safe app seriously. We've had about 20,000 users to date, which obviously is significantly larger than our campus population, but it also means that people who are coming in to campus are really taking it seriously about using the Bison Safe app, and so for that I'm thankful. The other thing that I think is important is looking at things like mental health and counseling. I saw a couple of questions about this, and these were in the presentation. We've been expanding our services with respect to counseling. I think every university campus in the country has this issue. We can't hire enough psychologists quick enough. And also, I think there's significant burnout, so there's high turnover as well as we're hiring. But this is an unmet need that I will acknowledge, and want an area that we're certainly investing in and trying to get more resources to as well. With respect to COVID testing, the news here is not great. We've had a significantly suppressed positivity rate for some time on campus, and now, unfortunately, we don't. We're up to 5%, I think, based on the numbers I heard just yesterday as well. Since these numbers don't include this week, it's pretty alarming. We had one day with over 100 positive tests. We have about over 200 students now in some form of quarantine, and as we get students out of quarantine, because they'd be on day five, or if they're still testing positive and get to day 10, we are putting students back in just as quickly. So this is an issue, and that's the reason for the communication yesterday. Since DC raised the mask mandate, this was something that we were concerned about in terms of the impact. So although on campus we have maintained our masking policy, the the reality is that obviously we're living in a city where we're mobile, we're going back and forth. Yesterday, quite a number of the people who tested positive actually live off campus. And so this is a difficult one to control. And for the sake of full transparency, so there's no question about the intent here, we want to have commencement in person. I don't want us to get into the last week of April with a high infection rate that may threaten having an in-person commencement, and that's why I'm taking the measure to go virtual now so we could try to suppress the infection rate, especially among seniors, and that's why I'd like every non-graduating senior, if they can make the appropriate arrangements, to leave campus right after classes have ended. And that way we can have, you know, a smaller number of people on campus, hopefully keep the graduation rate down, and then have in-person graduation. Last year, we did have an in-person graduation. I think doing it without family and friends, I think everybody would agree, just takes something away from it. And also not being on the yard as well, I think, is another thing that affects that. Now, obviously, weather could take us away from there, but the reality is we would like to have an in-person graduation. So all the measures we're taking, we're trying to protect the opportunity to do that. I think if we leave campus open, we do exams on campus, we get closer to graduation week, and we run the risk of having to pull all of that stuff down. And you can see here, as I said, we've been increasingly getting better. That 20% you'd note was during the Omicron surge back in November, December, I believe it was. And then we had a pretty good suppress rate. We were concerned about what would happen after spring break. Again, I have to commend the entire community that after spring break, we didn't see the type of spike that we thought we'd see. But obviously now, today, we're seeing a spike that's pretty concerning. Nobody's being hospitalized. People are having mild symptoms. And so we're thankful for that. But at the same time, we want to be careful. We have people who are immunocompromised in our community, like myself, and so, you know, there are risks with us getting the infection and passing it on, and so we have to be concerned not just about ourselves, but we have to be concerned about our other community members as well. In terms of the type of investing that we're trying to do, and I'll talk about the finances of the university and how that blends with what we're trying to do with respect to real estate, et cetera. But the idea here is to make sure that we can have revitalized facilities that would provide a world-class experience for teaching, research, and all types of scholarship activity. And so I'll walk you through kind of what the plan is and what that looks like. We've announced that we'll invest about $785 million to build three different areas that would provide world-class facilities. And this is a lot of construction that will take place over the next 4 to 5 years. So one of the first things we have to look at is the academic buildings. We haven't had a new construction of an academic building on the campus since 84. We've had two libraries and a research building, but in terms of a core facility that houses faculty and teaching classrooms, we haven't had that for some time. So the majority of funds will go into this. One would be a health sciences complex, so the med school, the dental school, nursing allied health, and pharmacy will all see new buildings in that health sciences complex. Center for Arts and Communication will house the Chadwick Boseman College of Fine Arts and the School of Communications as well, the Cathy Hughes School of Communications. It's important for us to bring that about as well so we can get more collaboration. I remember one of the things that one of the fun conversations that I had with Chadwick Boseman was about him doing a movie with Bradford Young, who was in the Cathy Hughes School of Communications, and he and Kelechi Watson from the College of Fine Arts did a movie, which they all apparently promised never to show anyone. But the point is that they found each other more by accident than by design, and I think we have an opportunity to try to get them in spaces where they could collaborate. STEM complex, which would house a lot of the activity we have now in physics, chemistry, biology, those three buildings obviously are not in the best condition, and so trying to replace those as quickly. The new construction projects are slated to begin this year, and all of this should be completed by about 2026. So we've gone out and secured bond funding, obviously, as part of this to make these come to fruition. Our student housing, which has come up as a concern, I also want to remind you that we supply student housing for freshmen and sophomores, as do most universities throughout the country. And that's because a lot of juniors and seniors have different types of activities. Some of them, depending on how well their matriculation has gone, actually as a senior, may not even have a full-time experience by the spring semester. And so our policy has always been to house freshmen and sophomores. In terms of the housing that we plan to come still, we're planning about 1,200 extra beds, which will add to our inventory. Sherman Avenue, we own some property on Sherman Avenue, and that would allow us to put up two housing complexes. There, we want to put apartment-style housing, especially targeting our graduate and professional members who may come with families, et cetera. You have quite a few members in the graduate and professional schools who are into their 30s, they've started a family. It's a little difficult to move into the DC area because of pricing, and we think offering them some opportunities there would be helpful. The Fusion building would include student housing as well, and that's currently where that Wonder Plaza area is. We have an RFP out where the goal here is to do mixed retail, but to put student housing there as well. Batoon Annex is slated for a renovation as well, and then we would like to try to decompress some of the activity that's taken place in Bird Gymnasium and create a new Howard Union where students can go and participate in everything from cooking to exercise, yoga activities in the new Howard Union. This will be facilitated by us moving Dean Williams and her team out of what was a temporary building 36 years ago. That's a long temporary status. And the goal is to move School of Education and the middle school for math and science into the minor building, which is next to the A building. And that as well would be a full renovation. One of the things that this does not solve for that we still need to be thoughtful about is the middle school students don't have a great place for physical activity. And that has to be a cornerstone of you know, what we provide for them. So we still have to look into an appropriate long-standing solution for that. And we know that the DC government is planning to build a middle school at the top of Banneker, and so there may be an opportunity there for us to have some type of a partnership, and that's something that we're going to look into. We're going to build a new hospital. This hospital was built in the same year that I was born, 1971, opened in 1974. I should say construction started in 71. And so, as you can imagine, the way my knees feel, this building is a little sick as well. And so we certainly need to replace this building, especially given the activity that we have. Now, sometimes we don't connect the dots on this, and I'm going to try to do that today. We have the seventh most selective medical school in the country, but we have the fifth most inexpensive medical school in the country. So we received 8,500 applications last year. We only enrolled a class of 126. But of that 126, 79 of those students, Howard is the only place they got into and got a spot. So we have a selection bias, which is the kind of selection bias that you want to have. We think we can double the size of the medical school and have a class of 250. When you look at what has happened in the pandemic and you look at what's necessary, I think it's extremely important. And so you know we've had a long and arduous discussion with the District of Columbia government as they were building a hospital in Southeast. We've now had a partnership with Adventist, and one of the reasons I think that we have not been able to make it clear to the citizens of DC, but I think it needs to be clear to the entire country, is that the pipeline that Howard provides for diverse medical talent is unmatched. We send more African Americans to medical school. We graduate and train more African Americans in medicine than any other institution. And I've said this before, if we stop doing it today, it would still take the schools at number two and number three probably 25 years to catch up to the numbers that we have produced so far. So this is not just a critical component of what we do for the nation, but it's one that has to be invested in. And so we're thankful for the support we received from the DC government, and we recently received $100 million from Congress to support the building of this hospital. It's a $650 million facility. We've also set this up so that if we need to expand the hospital in the future, we are going to have land right adjacent and a plan to expand it. It will be in the middle of that complex that will house the health sciences and STEM as well. So I want us to be thinking about this as an academic medical center and not just a hospital. And I think that that gets lost. The fact that we need to train diverse talent and we do it so well is what makes this facility extremely unique and I think extremely critical. So I think in terms of getting here and the campus master plan, which I would encourage folks to look at, we had to make strategic choices along the way in terms of what we needed to do to shore up the finances, to ensure that we could pay for these things and to get there. It hasn't always been easy. I think I've always been open about the fact that it wouldn't always be easy. And when I think of when I started my presidency, the hospital alone was losing about $68 million that year. And so, and we raised that year probably just shy of $5 million that year. So the finances just weren't great. Our four-year graduation rate as well was 38%. So if you look at any category of what we were doing, we could have done it better. And I think there was an opportunity for us to do that. So in terms of the financial, you know, sustainability, so the funding for the real estate projects, one is the bonds. We went out with a bond prospectus. We went to Wall Street. We got a credit rating. And despite the fact that we were going to add $300 million in debt, actually, they rated us based on adding $500 million in debt because we intend to participate in something I'll discuss on the next slide. They still gave us a credit rating increase for that. So again, that speaks to the financial health of the university. So we've already finished the bond issuance. We have that cash in the bank. So this is not an issue of monies to come or we're planning to do something. We actually have the cash and now we have to go out and implement and execute on that strategy. Federal funding is also extremely important as well. In the federal appropriation, we receive $100 million assigned to the hospital as well. So again, that money is there. The total project is $650 million. DC government gave us a tax abatement for about $225 million. So we obviously have to try to monetize that to help with paying for the hospital. So we have lots of things in place to green light that project and to get started there as well. We will participate in the HBCU capital financing program. This is a Department of Education program that helps with low-cost capital financing to HBCUs. Howard has long been excluded from this. We were able to convince OMB this year to include us, and Congress passed a bill putting us back in. For those of you who, you know, go back and kind of search everything I say, you won't see Howard in the legislature. You'll see an institution that was started in 1867 is how it's described in this in the legislation. So let me just say that in case somebody Googles this issue and doesn't see Howard specifically in the legislation. This is a huge help for us, that HBCU capital financing program. The interest rates are well below market, and therefore they allow us to borrow money at a much lower rate, so therefore obviously paying back this is certainly more manageable. And as I said, we had a credit rating improvement, and that has been the trend since negative outlook in 2018. And I think that that trend can continue based on some of the information on the next slides. So undergraduate alumni giving is something that we've been tracking. Right now, when you look at 21-22, we had about 12.2%. To put it in perspective, funny enough, the Claflin University president, his wife and daughter were just in my office. They decided instead of doing Disney for spring break, they were going to come to Howard. So I was joking with his 10-year-old daughter and told her, I'm sure this is much better than Disney. And unfortunately, in front of him, she agreed. So I'm probably going to get some heat from him about that. But I was telling him that I always put Claflin up on my slides for their alumni giving, which is phenomenal. And as you can see here, it has been as high as 50.4% industry-wide, not just HBCUs. Industry-wide, their numbers are phenomenal. and their last year was 38.4. You can see Spelman, which has always been strong. The average for HBCUs is actually 10.5, and we now kind of live around that average or a little higher. I've said it before, we need to get to 25 to 30%. What I will say, though, is despite the fact that we're not at 25 to 30%, one consistent thing that has been happening every year is the quantity of alumni giving has been going up. And so that is something as well we're very thankful for as well. So how are we doing in fundraising? You can see back in 17, we were just under 20 million, and that actually was probably double what we were doing on average at that time. The strategy here was let's build the infrastructure. In fiscal year 20, we actually received four of the five largest gifts the university ever received, and that obviously was before the pandemic and obviously before the unfortunate murder of George Floyd. Last year, we were able to raise $175 million, and that included two very significant gifts, one from Mackenzie Scott, and she has changed the landscape of how people give. I got an email from somebody other than her, and we had cash on hand in probably 10 days via wire. I still have that receipt in my office just to make sure that it's real. Every now and then I call the CFO to make sure the $40 million is still there. But it's a different kind of giving. No restrictions on how to spend it, et cetera. And that you have to remember, these are transformative gifts. You could give somebody $40 million to only put a pink post on the yard, right? And that's not going to serve us well. But when you give somebody $40 million and say, you know, you do whatever it is you think is necessary with it, it's really, truly transformative. But what I'm happy to report is that this year, through 8 months, through February, we've raised $150 million already. So despite... So despite the fact that last year was record-breaking, we are well beyond that total year-over-year already. And this is without those two single large gifts, and I want to remind people of that. So the infrastructure we've built, the mechanism, the officers, the engagement is real and palpable, and it is sustainable, in my opinion. But it still means that we have to put our best foot forward, whether it's in the media, on social media, whatever venue it is. We have to consistently be making sure that we're making the right type of ask, and we're having the right types of conversations and things that people may want to invest in as well. So we've seen that continued growth in our gifts. As I said, we raised $177 million last year. I used to look at Stanford and Harvard. They raise about $1.6 billion a year. And I used to think they raise twice our endowment in a year, just to give you perspective on that. Right? And I just spoke to the Claflin president, and he was just telling me about their fundraising. And I was thinking, everything is relative in terms of where you are and what you're trying to do and where we're trying to move. And remember, among the HBCUs, we have a hospital, we have a med school, we have a law school, which means that we have alum who also fit into a different wealth category. And so we should be raising significant amounts of dollars as well. And so again, what Claflin does is absolutely fantastic. So that record-breaking growth, I think, in our fundraising is important. And so as you look at that, as you look at alumni giving rates, we have to start thinking about a comprehensive fundraising campaign. And where we set that bar is probably going to be transformative for HBCUs. And so I think we have to think about that as well, right? Morehouse just announced a $500 million campaign. I think they've raised about 40% of that. This year, we may raise what they have raised as part of that campaign already in just 1 year, to give you perspective. So we really have an opportunity, I think, in the next 3 to 4 years to get that done. And so the endowment also has been impacted in this. And I think this is an important slide. It's a little bit busy. One of the goals we've set for ourselves is to get to $1 billion. We had probably about 830. The script on here is a little small, 838 probably. We have a couple of things that we have to do that are accounting things. So we're going to have to move the Mackenzie Scott gift completely into the endowment. That is a process by our bylaws. We'll have that done by the end of June. and we have a couple other things that we need to do. By the time we do those things, we should be on the precipice of $900 million in the endowment. That means that we are within touching distance of having a billion-dollar endowment. And at the rate that we're raising funds and the investment cycle, and of course, given the geopolitical environment, what investments may do, obviously, is unpredictable. If anything, people are probably a little bit down on the economy. But the reality is that we're within touching distance of a billion-dollar endowment. This is in spite of taking $80 million out of the endowment and putting it into the pension plan. And the reason that I suggested that to the board and they approved it was because I wanted to make sure our retirees, at the time that the pandemic hit, did not have a concern about the security of their pension. So our pension plan is now funded at about 109%. And so we feel very, very good and comfortable. The dollars in there are also invested conservatively as well. So our retirees are taken care of in terms of the security of their pension. And obviously, if we didn't move that money, we probably would have a billion-dollar endowment now. But the reality is that there's an opportunity. I will explain a little later how the endowment works, because I think there's sometimes a misunderstanding. It's not a checking account or a piggy bank. It is something that you want to sustain in perpetuity. So you want to be investing. You want that investment to spin off a certain return every year. This year was about 20-something percent. But then you want to take some portion of it and spend it on day-to-day operations. So what we generally do is we use a 4% rule of the average of the endowment for the past 3 years for our spending. And that makes good sense because it means that those dollars are going to be there for tomorrow. If we were just to take all the money and spend it, we could do that. We could take all the money out of the endowment and spend it and fix everything on the campus all at once. And then we would have no more money, right? So we'd be sitting down in nice buildings and not able to run the place at all. And just to compare, and I think this is very important. I think we will be the first HBCU to have a billion-dollar endowment, but let's just, I think, be sobering about what it takes to run a university and where we're competing. All of these schools are schools that our students get into and choose to come to Howard. And you can see the difference in the endowment. So if you use that 4% rule, as I just described it, or 5%, some of them are at 5%. I believe Harvard uses 4%. But let's say for easier math for me, we use 5%. 5% of their $50 billion, right, is $2.5 billion. So if they took $2.5 billion every year from their endowment to run the place, they could run Howard University 2.5 times. Our revenue last year was $1.1 billion. Harvard could take 5%, the 5% spending rule of their endowment, and run this entire place 2.5 times. Right, so just to give you the gravity, when we talk about finances, because I know sometimes people get uneasy because I talk about making the place financially secure, but in order for us to be the best, we have to do that in the right way. I said this when I started my presidency, and it's still true today. We're doing God's work, but we can't do it on God's time or God's money because I don't have access to the latter two. So we have to have a sound plan in order to make sure that we can bring it to fruition. Right? And this is where some of that just gets you into a reality of what it looks like. When you look at how our revenue comes in, again, this is a very important slide. You will see on this slide that when we took over, the federal appropriation was something we were heavily dependent on. Right? It made up more than 25%. Closer to 30-something percent of all of the revenue that was coming into the university. That's 200-something million a year. So again, the other gentle reminder I want to leave with everyone is that when we have to interact with the government, regardless of who's in the White House or who is in the Senate or who is in the House, it is because I have to talk to all of those people to ensure every year that they approve a line item federal appropriation of that magnitude. And this is not a congressional act that happens every year. In other words, somebody could get up in the next sitting of Congress and suggest that we should not give Howard any money. And that person can gain enough momentum. It's a bill that needs to pass. You guys have been seeing what has been happening in a divided Senate. So you just have to have a majority, and the majority carries the day, and all of a sudden we don't have a federal appropriation. Now, everybody says to me, politically, that's not going to happen. I think we've seen enough stuff happen politically over the past 6 years that nothing can be left to chance, right? And so regardless of what our political persuasion is, we have to have engagement to make just one simple argument that an investment in Howard is an investment in the nation. The nation is much stronger if Howard University is stronger. And based on the congressional officials, the senators and congressmen and women I spoke to yesterday to inform them about my announcement, I could tell that the interest level, the concern, and the love that they have for this place is genuine. But they also understand that it's self-serving in the fact that if this university is strong, they have a strong institution that is indicative of the country. And so what you can see in 2021, so you can see contributions made up, 2% of our revenue. I said when I stood here before that we needed to diversify the revenue stream. And here we are in fiscal year 2021 and showing that contributions are now 25% of that revenue stream. Federal appropriation is less and less. I had suggested that we come up with a 10-year plan that we can slowly but surely decrease the dependence of the university on that so that, again, if there's something catastrophic does happen, we could be in the right place. And so I'm happy to say that I think we're trending in the right place. Last year, we had a banner year, but it is built on prior years in terms of trend. And so the bottom line for the university in terms of operating results have been improving, because every time we have a positive bottom line, we now have free-flowing cash that we can put back into the operations as we build next year's budget. And so last year, we had $204 million as our bottom line, obviously a very significant year. However, not unusual anymore for us, because this year already we have a bottom line of about $128 million, and by the time we get appropriate accounting of our full appropriation and those types of things, we probably are on track to repeat that. So again, the sustainability and consistency of what we're doing is the other thing that I want to emphasize, that these are not, that last year was not a flash in the pan year. Facilities and real estate in terms of the more recent renovations and relocations, especially for alum who may be listening or people on the other parts of the campus who don't always get to these places. Undergraduate libraries fully open. I've seen some, or been shared some posts where people were suggesting that the undergraduate library isn't open. It's been open, fully renovated, and we encourage people when they come to campus, you know, to come and take a look. The Frederick Douglass Memorial Hall as well, where I took a lot of my classes as an undergrad student, is also fully renovated. And obviously we've had the construction of the IRB, the research building as well. We have a couple other things that are going on that will help with housing as well. For those who want to live off campus but stay close, want to be in an apartment style residence, we have the Effingham Apartments on Georgia Avenue, and construction has taken place. I believe they're doing the demolition. And the goal here, as you can see depicted, is to build a facility there. One of the things that we want to do there is to put in an alumni center. As well, and to move development offices there as well, so that as part of the gateway of the campus, as you come into the campus, you'd have a space. I see Frank looking at me closely. I think Office of University Communications is going in there as well, so everybody's making sure they carve out their space. The Howard Manor, which is the building opposite, kind of opposite the gym on that block, will undergo a full renovation as well. And all of these buildings, we have affordable housing deals with the developers as well for a certain number of units, given the prices of what, you know, that have been kind of advertised around. And so on the campus master plan, just want to remind folks, as you think about the campus master plan, I want you to think in terms of the various blocks that exist on the campus and what's going to be happening there. So one was improving the student residential experience. The Tubman Quadrangle underwent a full renovation. For those of us who know that building from way back when, there were no connectors. You had to go all the way to the basement to get along every floor. We were able to build in connectors as well and fully gut and renovate this building. As I mentioned before, on Sherman, we want to bring apartment-style residences. The Wonder Plaza site, that RFP is out. I believe we've already appointed a developer, and the goal here is to put mixed-style use as well as there'll be some limited housing in there as well. Improving the academic environment is a big part of the focus, as you heard earlier as well. And so just some more details on the Center for Arts and Communications will live at the north end of the campus behind the current Childers Building. That Childers Building was actually built by a very famous black architect, and therefore I'm sure we'll get some historic designation, and so we're planning to build the new part on the back part of it and then renovate things like Ira Aldridge Theater. The Health Sciences Complex will go into the building where School of Communications is. That C.B. Powell building has been a challenge. There's a stream that apparently runs underneath it, and that's something that we're going to have to look at pretty closely as well. And the STEM Center, as mentioned before, will be next to it. So apart from just the hospital, we're also going to have a medical office building at that complex. So where all the practitioners are, not just the physicians, but we have to start thinking of the nurse practitioners, accommodating space for speech pathologists, et cetera, in that building as well. The power plant. That project is going well. This is a complete renovation of the power plant. One of the concerns that I have already is once we get the power plant working optimally, can the buildings with the older pipes tolerate the volume and pressure of steam that would now be coming to them? And so that's why doing some of these other renovations and doing new buildings is going to be necessary as well, so that we don't have pipes bursting in those buildings and leaks, et cetera. Green Stadium, as you know, we've never had a box. We've built a box. However, this is still inadequate. We have six lanes on the track, and to host an NCAA Division I meet, we need eight. So the athletic complex is something that we have to start looking at. And obviously, we will be engaging with the D.C. government. I think Banneker is a nice site for a new field house and stadium, but I'm not going to push that here today. But it might be helpful for us to partner with the city around something like that. Blackburn Center has undergone a full renovation as well. The basement is being done now and fixing the bowling alley, but also creating a space for some activities down there as well would be helpful. And then, obviously, the lower quadrangle, there's still minor things that occur on the campus that we take for granted. I came to school here in 1988. I never saw this fountain working. And I always wondered why. And obviously, now when I go down in that valley and I see the fountain working, I'm pretty pleased about it. But those are minor things that we sometimes overlook, but I think there's some aesthetics that we can control. And as I mentioned, the undergrad library, where I probably spent most of my time studying, is now a very modern facility. Douglas Hall was a significant project for us to undertake, and obviously this building was significantly damaged by the steam plant issue, and now I think we have a modern facility. We've hosted a couple of folks in there, including the Democratic senators, when they came for their retreat meeting, and it's really a nice space to be in. Enrollment is important. We've had record enrollment. This is the largest enrollment we've ever had as an institution. However, the reality is that enrollment is down across the country. The number of graduates from high school is going down, and that's proving to be a significant problem. And obviously, I think some of our challenges in the media is going to suppress our enrollment, everything from protests over student housing to issues such as the bomb threats, et cetera. And so we have to really look very carefully at what we do with respect to closing the class. We have high inflation. So while people are being employed, what they're spending their money on is changing. And that is going to prove to be challenging as well, I think, for low-income students to be able to come to Howard University. I'm starting to see those emails about people asking for more aid who we've accepted. And so this year is going to be a challenging year, but it's something that we need to continue to look at very carefully. And you can see over our history, as I said, this is the largest class that we've ever had. and our retention actually is doing well as well. Pell eligible enrollment, the percentage of the Pell eligible students is pretty stable in terms of our enrollment. But one of the things, again, that we need to look at is that because we have large enrollment, we actually have a larger number of those students. And that obviously is going to put more pressure on our resources and something we need to look at as well. The three-year student loan cohort default rates is something that we continue to look at, because as students take out debt, that's one issue, but what is happening when they take out debt? Are they able to pay it back, et cetera? And obviously after the recession, that default rate went up. Since the recession, it's been coming back down, and you can see that we are down at 6%. For all private nonprofits, it's about 5%. But the HBCU national average is at 15.4%. And when we look at our peers in Morehouse and Spelman, Morehouse is at 8.3% and Spelman is at 3.5%. So this is an area we want to get that number down. We want to get it down probably around 5%. But it is a sign of the financial health of our students on the way out. It's one thing if they can come in, can we keep them and get them through without them, you know, having to break the bank, as it were. The average full-time faculty salary, this is one of the areas that we try to work on as well in terms of looking at payments and what the market looked like. And so we went ahead and gave a 21% increase to the faculty. Now, one of the things that I want to make clear is that when we look at, where this issue was and putting it in perspective, I had no problem increasing the tenured faculty salaries in January. And the economics of the deal with the unionized adjunct faculty wasn't my issue, not the economics. The issue was the seven-year rule. And I felt strongly that that was something that we should be very careful about how we negotiated. So the economics wasn't an issue. And the economics that we agreed to created a substantial and appropriate salary range for the adjunct faculty. They're a key part of what we do, and I think needed to be rewarded as well. But the issue of the seven-year rule, I felt, was something that we should look at carefully. And so you can see in terms of the increase in faculty salaries, we've obviously had a significant bump this year and an important rise in it. And now we have to make sure as well that we obviously stay consistent as well. Improving net tuition revenue was an aspect of what we needed to do better. The average student coming in to Howard was getting about 75 to 80% of their course discounted. And again, the economics of that in terms of net tuition wasn't good. So we were not collecting very much on net tuition at all. We've raised more money to support those students via endowed scholarships, and therefore that has allowed us to really impact our net tuition revenue in a positive way. And you can see that growth is part of what has helped our bottom line as well. And as I mentioned on the front end, we've seen a significant fall off in terms of applications this year. After hitting a high of almost 30,000, we had just under 20,000 this year. And so we have to look at that closely. The graduate student population at this point, that application number is pretty strong and consistent. I highlight places like the law school that have been strong over the years, and obviously medicine as well has been strong. The other thing that the faculty need to take great pride in is faculty continuing to participate in research. Proposal submission year over year again has gone up significantly from 115 million to 187 million. And I think that's very good. We are on pace to exceed 100 million in awards for the first time. We were pretty close last year, I think close to 100, if not at 100, but this year I think we should comfortably pass that. And so that sets us up going forward to really be an R1 research enterprise as well. And so I think that's important for us to regain that status, and we are on track to do that. We're looking at several things. One is a new National Climate Laboratory and Center. We have several faculty from multiple disciplines that are participating in this activity. We want to use our Bellsville campus to build this facility. It would be the 19th national lab if the Department of Energy so approves it, and it would be the only one associated with an HBCU. There is interest in them having it be a center. We're going to keep pushing hopefully that they will designate this as a lab. And I think if we can bring a national lab to the campus, that's probably $1 billion to $1.5 billion in terms of infusion of research dollars and activity that could take place around that. And we have the opportunity as well to build a research park around that activity. So I'm grateful again for the faculty who are partnering here. We're partnering with Battelle. And for the sake of full disclosure, I'm on Battelle's board. Battelle is a nonprofit research organization that actually manages 8 of the 17 labs, national labs. So they're very good at doing this, and we felt it would be helpful for them to lend us some support. And again, we've been a leader in this. There's several faculty members on this campus who've done a fantastic job in this area and have left us certainly poised to be able to do this as well. And like I said, there's several benefits of having a national lab. There are key partnerships that we have as well that are ongoing. One that we need to add to this is the new Amazon site is an opportunity as well for us to have more activity there. They've been talking to us about potentially bringing our data science center there. And again, I think being part of that complex and what it portends for research and entrepreneurship in the region is important. A couple of key hires, Benjamin Tolton has joined us from Temple to run the Moreland. He and Ta-Nehisi Coates always tell stories about sitting in there studying together. And so, you know, having him come back here as a full professor in history to run this is certainly a delight to have him. We've had digitization of the Black Press Archives. We have a $2 million challenge grant that needs to be matched. And the goal here is to obviously digitize the archives that we have. We need to actually do that for all of our holdings, and that's something that's ongoing and an activity that we're trying to raise funds for as well. In terms of student outcomes, professional development is extremely important. You know, I talk a lot about workforce development, trying to get students more matched with industry so that they're prepared to go out into the world and do great things. And so we've had a lot of partnerships to try to get there, but also in terms of what we provide them in terms of tools is important. And I should mention, since we're in the School of Business, that a team from the School of Business that participated in Goldman Sachs challenge just yesterday won the first prize, which was $1 million. So we certainly congratulate them as well. We have to have a 21st century curriculum. I know there's a lot of questions about online learning, and that's certainly something we're doing more. We've signed a contract with 2U, our Masters of Social Work. We have an online program for that, and we're going to be expanding those offerings as we go forward. For the Office of Faculty Development, this has been a really, really important part of the activity that the Provost's Office has provided. They have done summer academy workshops. A lot of those graduates of that program have gone on to do well. 24% of them have been promoted in past academic year, as an example. And also the Chair Leadership Academy is important. You know, I've said it before, I think in higher ed, you basically excel in higher ed because you do academia well. And then somebody appoints you to be a chair or a dean, or for that matter, a provost or president, and then gives you HISUs, finances, all these other things that you weren't doing all along. And I think we've been very deliberate about trying to prepare people for that. Office of Undergraduate Studies has been run by Dr. Anderson over the past year, a difficult year, I think, to take over this, and he's done a fantastic job, so I'm thankful to he and his staff for the work that they're doing there. This has been influential in terms of getting students on the right track, keeping them on the right track for retention, et cetera. Alternative Spring Break celebrated its 28th year, and I want to thank Dean Richardson and Andrea Davis for the work that they've done here over the past year, and congratulate them on all the money they've raised, but more importantly, all the service that they've provided throughout the country and throughout the world. So we thank you very much for that activity. We have students who have been excelling. I'd point out Aisha Daring Benton is a winner of a 2022 Marshall Scholarship. This makes her the fourth Marshall Scholar in our history. And every year we've been adding to our rules. I think over the past 10 years, we've had more than in our prior decades of history at the University of Security. So let's give her a round of applause as well. We have several faculty who've been excelling. You know, Dr. Kane received the National Science Foundation Career Award. Dr. Grant Warner and Dr. Owolabi in the College of Engineering and Architecture as well received a significant award from DOD as well. Dr. Dana Williams in the grad school received an award from the National Endowment for the Humanities Initiatives, and Dr. Amy Yabor also received an award from the Mellon for the New Directions Fellowship. This list is long and could go on and on. I couldn't capture everybody, but I think there's just been a lot of activity. Dr. Carlo Williams in the Cancer Center received a $4.08 million award from the American Cancer Society. I'm on the American Cancer Society's board, but I joined the board after this was done, so I can take no credit. I showed up to my first meeting and they announced this, and I sat there and nodded as if I knew something about it. So this was fantastic to see. Dr. Burge is a principal investigator for an $8 million grant from NIH as well. And so we're thankful for them. So let's give them a round of applause as well. We had about 17 participants in the Chair Leadership Academy this past year. And that's a number that we want to continue to expand as well, and we want to make sure that we have enough faculty who are getting the opportunity to get this exposure. We think it's extremely important that we do that. Settler is a major part of what we're doing, and especially as we think of going into online, this is an area that we have to expand and an area that we will continue to be working on fairly diligently. Some of the new initiatives include the Center for Applied Data Science and Analytics. We received a $5 million grant from MasterCard. And the provost has been spearheading this effort. The Center for Journalism and Democracy that we've stood up, that's run by Nicole Hannah-Jones, has support of in excess of $20 million on the way to $25 million. And that center is getting established as well pretty soon. There's several other areas that we've been working on as well, including getting funds and support for the new Chadwick A. Boseman College of Fine Arts. And we intend to have a appropriate opening ceremony for that new college as well pretty soon. And then just close, when we look at investing in our people, right now obviously we are in negotiations with the DCNA. Bargaining status, you know, I think what Adventist Health Center has put forward is a very strong deal. They've added $11 million to the payroll. I've said this privately, and I'm very comfortable saying it publicly now. I'm happy that Adventist was negotiating that deal, because if I was, I don't think we'd get there. $11 million is a significant increase in the expenses for the hospital. 30% of the nursing staff at the hospital are now travelers. Not by our design, but that's just by what's happening in the country. Everybody is traveling and moving because of the kinds of money that they can make. But we have to do this in good faith. So we went ahead last week and started paying the nurses at the improved rate, although we don't have a signed agreement. And I don't like negotiating these things in public. I don't think it's the right thing to do. My mother was a nurse for 51 years, and I absolutely have a ton of respect for what nurses do. My residents will tell you, I tell them, they haven't seen the patient unless they've spoken to the nurse. Nurses spend way more time with the patients, and what they do is invaluable. But we also need to make sure that we run the business of the hospital in a way that's sustainable. Two hospitals have closed in the city, and I would argue that part of it was not being able to get their wage systems in line with their activity. And if you increase the expenses so that it outstrips your revenue, that's not a sustainable business. And so we have to be realistic about what it is we're doing. And we also have to be honest as well. And that integrity of the process is important. So when I see folks getting on TV and talking about trying to make a living, and they make $225,000 last year, I'm not sure that that's the right tenor that we want to have. So we need to have a conversation. We're continuing to try to meet with the union. I'm going to make myself available as needed as well. But this is something that we have to solve, and we have to make sure that we do it in a way that the hospital can actually thrive. We want to expand the medical school to 250 a year. It's a very important clinical laboratory, so this is not just a hospital. This is an academic teaching hospital. And so everything that we do that hurts or harms the hospital actually hurts the pipeline of physicians and other workers in the city. So I think sometimes when people get involved in these issues, they look at it one-dimensional. And I just ask everybody to, you know, step back and try to look at what we're trying to do in terms of the wider outcome and just be mindful of what those economics look like and the fact that, you know, we've had two hospitals in the city not do very well over time. So we're going to continue, like I said, working with them, the faculty as well. Like I said, non-tenure faculty, we're able to bring that to a close. I never had any apprehension about the economics, just to be clear. We have stronger finances, and we're going to put that back into our people. I have no problem doing that at all, and that's something that we're going to continue to make sure that we do. Commencement 2022 will be in person. If we all cooperate and are careful about what we're doing with respect to COVID and following the guidelines and trying to keep the infection rate down, and it will take place on March 7th. You probably heard this morning our commencement orator would be Taraji Henson. I had an opportunity to call her. She's extremely excited about this, as am I, and I look forward to giving her an honorary degree. This obviously is the topic of yesterday. Now that we announced Taraji Henson, this is yesterday's news, so I'm not going to spend too much time on this. It's been a pleasure to serve as Howard 17 president. I think where the university is now is prime for a successor to take it in the right place. I think that person can close on a very substantial campaign that would be historic in the first 3 years of her presidency. And I think she can also cut the ribbon on probably 6 or 7 new buildings as well. So I certainly look forward to welcoming the 18th president and doing everything possible. I want to take a moment just to thank my family. I look back, I put all of these pictures in with my kids when they were that small because it just reminds me of how big they are now. They're both taller than I am. But more importantly, I think their insight and their, my son in particular, texted me yesterday a couple of times after the message went out. And those are messages that I don't think I'll ever be able to delete. So thank you. I'm happy to take the questions.
Good afternoon, Dr. Frederick. These questions were previously submitted by the Howard University community.
Before we take it, is there anybody in the audience who has a question that they want to pose who's here today? Okay, you go ahead.
First question, can you address financial aid opportunities, especially for international students, STEM students, and students who experienced challenges due to the pandemic?
Sure. You know, one of the things that obviously we've been doing, the biggest category of money we've been raising is for student support. This past year, we gave over $200 million in student aid to students. And, you know, that's a significant investment, as you can imagine. When I started, we were probably giving about 40-something million. So we've really put a lot of money into, you know, financial aid in terms of, you know, giving. The issue back then is when we were giving, we were actually just discounting the bill. So if we charge $100, we were giving people $40, you know, dollars, it was actually a discount. So we were just charging them less. Now what we're doing is if we give them $40, we're trying to make that $40 that we've raised, et cetera. And you've seen what we've done with fundraising, and that's improving. We still have a gap to fill, and we're going to get there. So I think there's a lot of opportunity. You know, and we certainly intend to try to preserve that opportunity. For the categories you spoke about specifically, international students, I think international students is, you know, that is a group of students that obviously it's a concern when you look at the currency, the exchange rate, et cetera. I was one of those international students. It's something that I'm very sensitive to. I mean, I got support while I was here, and I've told the story before. I left here on a $4,000 loan from the university to pay off my balance with 0% interest. So I definitely am sensitive to that. But we have to also remember that we're trying to spread resources amongst a large number of students. And in the STEM area, we've actually done a lot of that, in the STEM area in particular. A lot of what we're raising now, I mean, yesterday, you know, we were making a multi-million dollar ask of a donor to support students specifically in the humanities, as an example. So, you know, it's something that we still have a gap, I recognize that, but we're continuing, I think, to improve in terms of the amount of dollars that we're putting out.
Second question. If Howard University has such a large endowment, why are financial aid opportunities so limited?
Yeah, it's a great question. So, you know, let's do a little bit of math. So let's say the endowment is $1 billion. Let's own it, as the young people say. So let's say it's $1 billion, and we decide that we're going to spend 4% a year. Obviously, all of it doesn't go towards financial aid. It goes to other things as well to run this place. So even at 4% of $1 billion, we still are just putting in about four. When you think of that 4% that you put in, you want to be careful how you're spending that 4%, right? Because the reality is that you have several different needs that people are going to have, and you have to think about, you know, how do you distribute all of that? So let's say even at 40 million, you want to look at the operations of the place, et cetera, because we charge significantly less than our peers. So we don't bring in enough revenue to only rely on tuition. And so regardless of what we're raising, we still have to raise more in order to be able to cover all of that. Now, I'll be transparent with you. Can we get, and I think we are in an environment where, can we beg the question of, can the med school be free for students with need? You know, I hope so, because NYU Langone is free. Right? They don't pay tuition. We have needy students that could benefit from that, especially if we double the class. And so that's what we're out raising money for. Can every Pell Grant student attend Howard free? Right? That's what we're out raising money for. Right? We have a goal to try to raise money so that every Pell Grant student, we're starting with those with an expected family contribution of zero. We want to raise enough money to have an endowment that would help fill their gap. But just to give you the dollars involved, because 40% of our population are Pell Grant eligible students, and half of them have an expected family contribution of zero, we probably need an endowment north of, you know, $4 or $5 billion just for that, not for anything else, right? So again, I showed you the slides with, you know, the Harvards, et cetera. So to do all of the things that we want to do, to be quite honest, we probably need a $10 billion endowment. We're on our way, right? We're about to hit $1 billion, and we have nine more to raise. She has nine more to raise, whoever she will be. But I'm sure she'll be good at doing it.
How is the university ensuring compliance with COVID-19 testing? Yeah. And how is the university mitigating exposure risks, especially with difficulties social distancing in classrooms with 30-plus students?
Yeah, you know, this has been a difficult issue over the course of the year, but I think if we look at our data, it suggests that we were doing a pretty good job. And we do several things. One is we actually have a CLIA certified lab on campus that was donated by Thomas Fisher. That helps us. So the volume of testing we're able to do every day is unusual compared to any other campus. So that's the first thing I would say. The second thing I would say is, part of what we need is compliance from everybody, right? We need everybody to pitch in and to do the right thing. So when we say we want people to fill out a Bison Safe app, we want you to do that. And obviously, we want people to fill that out honestly and to take the right precautions. Because again, I just want to remind folks that if you get COVID, you may not get very sick, but you then become an opportunity, a vector to give it to someone else, like myself, who is immunocompromised. And that we want to avoid at all costs. So some of it is, you know, the community has to be honest and good to each other, and some of it is us looking at bias and safe app usage and those types of things. And then we started sending out notifications for those who didn't get tested on the right schedule to remind them to get tested. You know, we don't know where the pandemic is going to be in the fall. One of the things we may have to do is to start locking people out of Blackboard and those types of things if they don't get tested on the schedule that we expect as well, right? We're trying not to impose archaic rules, draconian rules, but a lot of it is based on the behavior. And in my opinion, so far, the behavior has been pretty good. As you saw, the infection rate was down. I think with this being in D.C., no mask, and the BA2 variant, I think we've hit a patch, and you can see what we're doing to mitigate this, to try to keep everybody away from each other by having virtual online learning.
Is Howard structured to provide an online degree?
Yeah, definitely. You know, I think what we're going to do with a master's in social work, we have an EMBA program that we've had for a few years that's online. So we have experiences. We need to expand those experiences and opportunities, and hopefully we'll get there. Hopefully we'll be able to expand it as rapidly as we can. Now, I still want to be clear that I still believe that the on-campus experience, the in-residence experience, is one of the things that makes Howard special. The types of relationships you develop, the types of things that you learn outside of the classroom are just as important. So we have to consistently be thinking of how do we maintain that environment and that opportunity while still expanding it. Can we do both? Absolutely. I lecture to the medical students. I probably have the highest attendance because they're probably curious to come and hear the president lecture if that's really real. And when I get in the classroom of a class of 125 medical students, and I hesitate to say this in front of Dean Mighty, there might be 25, and they tell me that that's probably one of the highest attendance. So the way people get their education is also different, and we have to accept that as well, right? People want to do it differently, but we have to think of what that means, especially to parents. You know, do parents come along with that, right? Are parents comfortable sending their kids here, having them in a dorm, taking a class online while they're in their pajamas, right? They might think it's expensive to send somebody all the way to DC and do that. Now, students seem to like that and don't complain about that. So we have to get some mix, you know, some middle ground. So I definitely think we are poised to do it, but I also think we need to be thinking more holistically about what else goes along with providing that education.
And continuing with the question submitted previously, what plans are being made to supply affordable off-campus housing?
Yeah, you know, as I mentioned in the slides, you know, Sherman Avenue, we want to put up some housing there. Again, we want to target probably, you know, graduate students, professional students with families, or even undergrad students with families. Sometimes we have single mothers on campus, and we want to support that. You know, we may have single fathers as well, so we want to support, you know, kind of that environment. And then with some of the other housing that's going to go up, as I mentioned before, we'll probably add about 1,200 beds to our inventory. So I think we're going to supply significant housing. Now, most campuses in the DMV supply about 40% of their student body with housing. We're probably going to tip 60, 70%. That's a high number. And you have to remember, if enrollment goes down, especially if it happens precipitously, you know, we are going to be responsible for those empty beds. And so having a large inventory in an era where enrollment may go down could be problematic. So trying to find that right balance is and that sweet spot, as it were. So I think by the time we put up the Sherburn Avenue complex, you know, we should have more than adequate inventory.
Thank you. Relevant to the other topics you discussed in the presentation, the critique is that the mental health facility is a bit understaffed and takes a long time to reply to students. What do you plan on doing about this?
Yeah, we've been collecting data on this, and I'll tell you what the data shows. I think just like everybody else, we're probably understaffed. We have to beef up the number of people that we have in terms of counselors. But as I said to you before, turnover is high. That's something that we have to look at. But we've been hiring significant numbers. We've gone to online platforms. We have people on call. We've been doing a lot in this area. I think it's an area that's only going to expand. Every other university president I talked to, this is a problem they're trying to solve for. And we're going to make every effort to try to close that gap as best we can. I do worry, just in general, across higher ed, as to how much this is requiring in terms of service. You know, the growth in this area has been exponential. And so we are committed to dedicating resources, but what I would tell you is I don't think we can do it fast enough for the demand. But we will plan on doing our best to catch up as much as possible. And so Dr. Evers and her team, you know, they are getting ready to submit their budgets, and this is a big area of growth for them in terms of trying to make sure that they have adequate staffing and resources for that area. And just to also underscore how serious we take this, for our board, our recent board retreat, one of the things that I put on as a topic was mental health, and I had one of the counselors come and give the board a presentation on exactly just what the need is and what the type of resources we're going to need to support it.
Thank you. And finally, this probably touches on your heartstrings as an alum. Are you considering how to ensure the essential pillars of the Howard experience, including the pinning ceremony and the welcome ceremony that the class of 2024 missed due to the pandemic, will still happen in some fashion over the course of their Howard career?
Yeah, well, first we just need to make sure there's no more pandemic. So I wish I can control that, and I'm sorry they didn't get that experience, but the reality is we had to do what's safe. I I'm doing everything possible to have in-person graduation, I know the pain that the past couple of classes have had to experience not having, you know, graduation in a normal way, and we're trying our best to mitigate that, and we'll do that going forward. For the class of 2024, I think as we plan the ceremony for the fall, provided again that we can do it safely, we'll certainly include them so that they have the opportunity to experience what they may not have experienced before.
That's all of our pre-submitted questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much for your audience. I'm going to run to my office. Hopefully some of the faculty are listening. I think I'm going to go take questions from the Faculty Senate from my office on their Zoom. So thanks very much, everybody. I appreciate your support. Thank you.